Hello, welcome to the lecture series on food technology. In today's episode, let's discuss about coffee and cocoa bean processing. In this episode, the topic divided into two parts as follows: coffee beans processing and cocoa beans processing. And further, each part is having the following five sections: introduction, history, benefits on health, processing steps, and conclusion. Let us see on coffee beans. The cultivation of coffee plants in tropical regions, actually the coffee beans grow inside the fruit like cherries. The seeds are removed from the cherries and are dried and hulled to removing the protective skin called parchment. The coffee beans are greenish in color and are subsequently roasted and various shades of brown depending on the roast style. The roasted beans are ground and soaking with hot water to make the coffee drink. Each coffee seeds contain over 800 natural chemicals. The chemical constituents of coffee beans are obtained from climate and growing conditions and genetic of the tree. Actually, breathing method is very important steps in coffee preparation because it will affect on these natural chemicals. Each of these factors affect the distinct taste of the final brew. History of the coffee plants. Coffee was first discovered in Ethiopia around 575 AD. Even though coffee crop cultivated extensively in Yemen, district of Arabia during 6th century in Yemen, it did not gain popularity until the 15th and 16th centuries. The Arabians guarded their coffee plants by making sure that no coffee beans were taken out of Arabian without first being roasted or boiled to destroy its germination power. In the 1600, Baba Budans, a Muslim pilgrim from India, smuggled some fertile seeds from Mecca and planted them in the mountains of Mysore in India. And later in 1699, a Dutchman named Enricus imported seeds to Java from India, and later it started coffee production in the Dutch colonies. From here onwards, coffee seeds and plants were sent to Botanical Conservatory in Amsterdam. These seeds were cultivated at the conservatory and were propagated and sent to many conservations throughout Europe. Thus, the Dutch took to the lead in propagating coffee in their colonies of Java, Sumatra, and Bali. The first coffee in Brazil was planted in 1727 from plants brought from France. However, significant coffee production in Brazil started after 1760 when João Alberto Castillo Branco brought coffee plants from Portuguese Goa in India. Similarly, coffee plantation was introduced in Cuba by Don Francisco in 1779. Coffee did not become a major crop in India until the British started emphasizing its production in the 1840s. However, it is said that the coffee seeds that Baba Budan brought from Yemen to India in the 1600 are responsible for propagation of coffee throughout the world. Coffee and health. The controversy over the effect of coffee is not new. Mainly, it is due to caffeine content. There are those who claim coffee to be cure some diseases and those who condemn coffee as monstrous carcinogen. Consumption of coffee has gone up and down depending on which side has more influence at the time. In the beginning of the 11th century, Arabian philosopher wrote about the medicinal benefits from coffee drink. During 17th century, when coffee started to penetrate the European market the business promoting coffee were losing business due to engaged in propaganda for and against the health effects of coffee. Even today, scientific researchers are coming up with beneficial or harmful effect of drinking coffee. For example, studies have looked at heart disease, cancer, Parkinson's disease and miscarriages. Some scientific reports are proved the health benefits of coffee as follows. Coffee is loaded with antioxidants and beneficial nutrients that can improve your health. Coffee can improve energy levels and make you smarter. Coffee can help you burn fat. The caffeine can drastically improve physical performance. There are essential nutrients in coffee. For example, riboflavin called as vitamin B2, pantothenic acid, vitamin B5, manganese and potassium, magnesium and niacin B3. Coffee may lower the risk of type 2 diabetes. Coffee may protect you from Alzheimer's disease and dementia. Caffeine may lower the risk of Parkinson's. Coffee can fight depression and make you happier. Let us see coffee processing. Irrespective of the harvesting method, green coffee beans and overripe coffee cherries inevitably end up mixed with perfectly ripe cherries and must be separated during coffee processing. Overripe coffee cherries, undeveloped coffee cherries, stick and coffee leaves float in water. Ripe coffee beans and green coffee cherries are dense and sink in water. Therefore, the first step in the coffee production consists of separating the floaters from the sinkers. The coffee floaters are usually sent directly to patio to remove floating unwanted material. The ripe and green cherries can be sent to the patios to be dried using the natural process or can be sent to the coffee pulping machines. Coffee processing equipments. The first stage of coffee pulping is used to remove the green coffee cherries from the ripe cherries. In the coffee pulping machinery, the internal pressure is monitored to push the coffee against a screen with holes only large enough for a coffee beans but not cherries to pass through. Since the ripe cherries are soft, the break and coffee seeds is released through the screen. Pulping coffee. The green cherries are hard and cannot be pulped. Instead of passing through the screen, the green coffee beans pass to the end of the barrel system and are separated from the ripe coffee beans. The pressure inside the barrel controls the quantity of cherries will be pulped. A very high pressure will cause all the cherries, including the green beans, to be pulped. It is necessary to continuously monitor the pressure so that maintain about 3% of ripe cherries with the green cherries. This margin of error ensures that no green cherries are mistakenly pulped with ripe cherries. The pulp coffee beans are then separated by centrifugal forces and barrel screen systems. Coffee fermentation. The coffee beans covered in the slippery mucilage can be sent to the patios to dry a pulped natural coffees or can be sent to coffee fermentation tanks. The coffee fermentation tanks are used to remove the mucilage before drying. The pulped coffee beans are put into the cement tank with water and are allowed to ferment for 16 to 36 hours. On the way to the fermentation tanks, another density separations can be occur. The highest quality coffees are the densest and should be separated and fermented in a different tank. The coffee fermentation time depends on a number of factors, including the amount of coffee fermenting, water temperature, and humidity. The mucilage is made up of pectin materials including protopectin 33%, reducing sugars including glucose and fructose 30%, non-reducing sugars such as sucrose 20% and cellulose and ash 17%. Protopectin is not water soluble and will hydrolyze to pectinic acid in the fermentation tanks. Hydrolysis of the protopectin and degradation of the pectin by enzymes is the process that occurs to remove the mucilage during the fermentation. Currently, the best way of determining the end of coffee fermentation is to feel the coffee beans to determine if they are still encapsulated in the mucilage. If the coffee beans are fermented for 36 to 72 hours, Stinker's beans develop lactic acid and propionic acids are produced in this process and are believed to prevent the traditional fermentation taste by inhibiting mold growth that regularly occurs during drying on the patio in humid conditions. Coffee drying. From the coffee fermentation tanks, the beans are moved to drying patios and dried to 11 to 12% moisture content. A small portion of the lots is hulled and milled by mini huller. 300 gram of coffee is classified for defects and the percentage of each screen size is determined. Then 200 to 300 grams of coffee is roasted in the sample roaster and cupped to determine coffee quality. Ideally, no lots will be mixed until coffee has been classified and cupped. The coffee remains in pergamino until shipment time to help protect the flavor and aroma of the coffee. So, let us see the second part of this presentation, cocoa beans processing. The botanical name for cocoa plant is Theobroma cocoa. These tropical trees produce white and pink blossoms right from the trunk or main branches. The white flowers are female and the pink flowers are male. The cultivation of cocoa trees under shade trees. History of cocoa beans. Cocoa beans is indigenous to Mexico and Central America. The first civilization of America and Mexico used cocoa for chocolate drinks. It was highly regarded a drink for the elite only. The word cocoa, originally pronounced cacao, was reconstruction by linguistic as a vocabulary item in Proto-Mexijacoan family of languages by about 1000 BC at the very height of Olmec civilization. The first European encounter with cocoa took place during Columbus voyage. On August 15, 1502, he came across a Mayan trading canoe with cocoa beans on the island of Gunja, now known as a Bay Island, 30 miles north of mainland Honduras. Columbus knew the cocoa beans encountered to be short of almonds and that the Mayan people treated them as a precious thing. He had no idea of their use in the preparation of the revered chocolate drink. Though there may have been an early introduction of cocoa on European soil, the first written account suggests that in 1544, Dominican friars took delegation of Mayan nobles from Alta Verpaza in Guatemala to visit Prince Philip in Spain. These noblemen took some beaten chocolate along with many other items as gift for Prince Philip. It was not until 1585 that the first official shipment of the beans reached Spain from workers. By the first half of the 17th century, recipe for hot chocolate with various spices like sugar, cinnamon, vanilla, red chili, etc. were used among the Spanish elite, and sweet solid chocolate preparations were also documented. Later on, English travelers introduced cocoa in England. it is easy to imagine that convents and friars must have played an important role in the propagating the product throughout the Europe. Like coffee, chocolate also underwent scrutiny regarding its pros and cons associated with health. Eventually, it is survived all that to become king of the universal plateau. Processing of cocoa beans. There has been no change of processing of cocoa beans from harvesting through drying. This is done in the producing countries. Harvesting. Once the flower are pollinated, the pods take 5 to 6 months to grow and mature to the yellowish red color of the ripened pod. The pods are harvested manually. Once harvested, they may keep for about a week before spoiling. After harvesting, the pods are carefully cut open with machetes and the beans with the pulp are removed. These are then placed in large boxes or just in the heaps, covered with banana leaves and left to ferment. The fermentation process gives flavor to the beans and the pulp slowly liquefies and runs off as the temperature rises. This takes up to a week. The beans start to germinate in the first couple of days of fermentation, soon to be killed by the high heat produced by the fermentation. This stage is very important since ungerminated beans lack of flavor. The moss is turned from time to time so hot spots don't develop and the temperature is maintained at around 110 Fahrenheit to 120 Fahrenheit. Roasting. When the dried beans are received at the factory, they are artfully roasted at 200 degree Fahrenheit to 250 degree Fahrenheit for 1 to 2 hours in order to develop the flavor of the beans. The beans become brown in color and friable. Next, the roasted beans are broken down and the thin shell is removed in the process called winnowing. The remaining pieces of kernel are called cocoa nibs, which have the final chocolate flavor as we know it. Nibs contain about 400 different chemicals responsible for the flavor of the final product. Grinding. The nibs are ground under heavy steel rollers with some heat. The grinding process also produces its own heat. The nibs changes into a thick paste called cocoa liquor and contain about 50 to 55% cocoa butter. Filtering the butter. Next, the liquor is filtered using hydraulic pressure to remove the colorless cocoa butter, which is a liquor. The cocoa in the form of cake remaining is used for further processing into cocoa, hot chocolate and cheap commercial chocolates. The cake contains about 10 to 20% butter. The high quality gourmet chocolate are made from cocoa liquor, making hot chocolate mix. The cocoa cake is pulverized by grinding, then mixed with ground sugar and milk powder. Artificial shortening agents and lecithin are added to make it easy mixed in water to form the drink. This is the typical commercial hot chocolate mix. The high quality gourmet chocolate like ours is made by pulverizing the cake, adding some cocoa butter and evaporated sugarcane juice and also bits of dark chocolate. There is no dairy products or other additives in the cocoa chocolates. The prepared drink can be made using milk, rice milk, soya milk or water and spicing if desired. The beans are then dried either on plastic for a couple of weeks or in an oven with a continuous turning in order to reduce the moisture content to about 7%. Then the beans are packed to be sent to chocolate factories, mostly overseas. Refining. The above mixture is refined through a series of rollers to give the chocolate its consistency by reducing the particle size of the mixture so that they cannot be felt on the tongue. The size is generally reduced to 20 millionth of a meter, smaller than the distance between two sensory taste buds in the mouth. The process also creates its own heat, which develops the flavor of the chocolate. Conching. The refined chocolate is further improved by grinding under roller of the machines called conch, because the resemblance of the shape to a conch or shell. Here, the refined chocolate is ground under granite rollers, which goes back and forth on the flat granite table with curved lips. When the rollers go back and forth on the lip, the mass splashes onto the roller towards the main body of the machine. This friction produces heat, develops the flavor, and drives out volatile acids while masticating the material. The process takes 1 to 3 days. High quality gourmet chocolates are still manufactured using similarly designed equipments, but the cheap commercial chocolate is produced on the equipment using heat and paddles to stir the moss to remove the volatile acids and develop flavor. Tempering. The final step before molding into the bars and other shapes is tempering. The cocoa butter, when cooled, forms two kinds of crystals, stable and unstable. Unstable crystals forms gray streaks known as bloom in the final chocolate. Also, the chocolate should have mostly stable crystals so it does not melt in the hand. To remove the unstable crystals, the chocolate is slowly heated to 180 degree Fahrenheit to melt all the fat crystals. Then it is cooled to 81 degree Fahrenheit to set the correct amount of stable fat crystals to provide the beginning of structures. Unfortunately, some unstable crystals are formed. To remove this chocolate's temperature is again increased to 90 degree Fahrenheit, which is warm enough to melt the unstable crystals but not the stable crystals. In the final molded chocolate, the stable crystal gives the basis to form the entire chocolate with the stable crystals. Let us see the health benefits of cocoa food consumption. Cocoa contains over 700 known compounds, and for all we know, there are maybe more than that remain undiscovered. Of particular interest to scientists are the antioxidant compounds in cocoa. Antioxidants are compounds that plants manufacture to prevent their own cells from premature destruction due to exposure to heat, light, air, moisture, and time. In the human body, many of these compounds prevent reactive oxygen species from destroying cells and causing premature aging and diseases. Cocoa beans is especially rich in polyphenols, a group of protective antioxidant compounds found in many plant foods such as red wine and tea, and which are the subjects of scientific investigations for their beneficial influence on cardiovascular health. The polyphenols include anthocyanins, isoflavones, flavonones, flavonols, flavanols, and flavones. Of special interest to health research are flavonols in cocoa, including flavone 3 holes, catechins, epicatechins, and proanthocyanidins. These naturally occurring substances not only protect the cells of our bodies from premature destruction, but they also help to reduce the risk of killer diseases. Cardiovascular diseases is the primary killer of adults. The polyphenols in cocoa are cardioprotective in two ways. They help to reduce the oxidation of low-density lipoproteins, or so-called bad cholesterol. Oxidation of LDL is considered a major factor in the promotion of coronary diseases, most notably heart attack and stroke. Additionally, polyphenols inhibit blood platelets from clumping together. The clumping process called aggregation leads to atherosclerosis, hardening of the arthritis. By inhibiting the aggregation of polyphenols, reduce the risk of atherosclerosis. Since atherosclerosis is a major killer of American adults, the protection provided by polyphenols in cocoa is of reveal the value. It can literally means the differences between life and death. Conclusion: coffee and cocoa beans are one of the nature's many miracles, is in fact the great superfood that many people seek. The beverages of these beans is a titan of health benefits, the likes of the which humanity has never known. Both coffee and cocoa beans are enriched with antioxidant polyphenols, terpenoids, etc. Therefore, the consumption of coffee and cocoa beans is an important dietary food in daily life. Thank you.